Okay. Got my chips. Okay. Okay, I'm good. So, we gonna... Okay, cool.
How much is that girl like?
It's been a truly strange year. After declaring the pandemic over by basically giving up and letting it ravage the world while pretending it doesn't exist, society has pretty much completely gone back to business as usual. But our dramatic and prolonged stumbling out of the gate has resulted in, among other things, a really weird pop music landscape. The music industry came to a screeching halt in 2020 and left a power vacuum wide open that TikTok was perfectly positioned to take advantage of, changing the rules of how music could get popular by allowing artists without industry backing to achieve unprecedented organic groundswell. The industry has caught up and basically swallowed it whole. But even with the industry's best efforts to understand TikTok's power, that original power vacuum seems to have reappeared, except nothing seems to be big enough to fill it. At least that's my theory for why nothing really seemed to stick this year, despite so much happening. For what it's worth, it wasn't for a lack of trying. A lot of really interesting music came out this year, both in the good and the bad, which made writing about music a lot more fun compared to last year, apart from the other two that we're not talking about. Dare I say, this might be my favorite top 10 list to date. Once again, I don't have strict rules for eligibility. If you can make a solid case for a song being popular with the general public in some capacity, it could be on here. My only real rule is the lead artist clause, which permits any given artist only one spot on the list as the lead artist, though they can appear again if they're a feature on someone else's song. Everything on this list is phenomenal, and I cannot wait to get into them. In fact, let's do it right now. These are my top 10 best hit songs of 2023. Actually, I lied. This year, for very special reasons, we actually have 11 songs on the list. I really try not to do stuff like this because I believe so strongly in the top 10 format, but this is an exceptional case. To show you what I mean, I need to honor a person who is no longer with us. And that person is me from 2019. Here's my ranking of Taylor Swift's new album, handwritten because I'm very passionate about it. In conclusion, please make Cruel Summer a hit single. I feel like if Cruel Summer gets the right promotion, we could get the best top 10 Taylor Swift hits in style. I'm aware that The Man is slightly more popular because it's been put on Spotify's and Apple Music's playlists, but please make Cruel Summer a single and a hit. Watch Taylor make Cruel Summer a single at the very end of the summer like Megan Thee Stallion did with Hot Girl Summer last year. To be honest, I'd be fine with Taylor not making Cruel Summer a single as long as she makes I Think He Knows a single instead. Given the circumstances of the world, I can't decide whether now's the worst time or the best time to release Cruel Summer as a single. Ooh woo, oh woo, it's a Cruel Summer. A new number one on the Billboard Hot 100, Cruel Summer by Taylor Swift featuring Playboi Carti. This could have been real with Ice Spice if Taylor wasn't a coward. People dream high in the quiet of the night, you know. 19-year-old Loeco would have been so thrilled to see this day finally come. They were rooting for Cruel Summer so hard, like I imagine many of you probably were back in the day. And it would have been such a good signature hit for an underrated album that they adored, much like I still do. If he were here today, he'd probably talk your ear off about how huge it feels, how Taylor takes you on a whirlwind of a journey through her clandestine relationship, with immersive verses, soaring choruses, and an intense bridge with an insane lead into the final chorus. That growl is so good. It was a pop masterclass, and 19-year-old Loeco would have absolutely let you know that. He probably would have put it at number 2 that year. Not number 1 though, because Don't Start Now was still blowing his mind way too much. It's a shame that 19-year-old Loeco isn't here right now, because I sadly don't share the same enthusiasm for it anymore. I still think it's really good, and it's fantastically composed and performed, but this production has really worn out on me. I've explained my piece on it before, but to reiterate, it has a similar problem to a lot of the tracks on Midnights, where everything in the mix gets swamped out into a synth-pop fog, eliminating any of the dynamics you'd want in a pop song almost completely. The nature of it on Cruel Summer is a bit different because the bass synths aren't as pronounced, so instead of blowing out your speakers with ugly, muddy bass like most of Midnights, everything kinda just floats in the middle, enveloping you in a huge oppressive cloud of nothing like you're being submerged in whipped cream. It's giving me nothing, and yet it's smothering me. It's really obvious that this is happening, especially when the song transitions into the bridge, where all of the fog suddenly vanishes from the mix, and you can actually hear Taylor's voice clearly for the first time without her being eaten by cotton candy. It almost makes me sad. It's like Taylor and Jack Antonoff are giving me a glimpse of good production before they take it away from me.
It's cruel. Summer. Who's that?
The worst part is that it dampens a lot of the song's impact. Every time the chorus starts, it feels like nothing's happening. Taylor sounds like she's singing a chorus, but all the song does is make the synths louder and tap on some drums for like a second. Everything good about the song is pretty much in spite of the production. Taylor's songwriting especially carries the song almost single-handedly. People dream high in the quiet of the night, you know that I caught it. Bad, bad boy, shiny toy with a price, you know that I bought it. Her verses sell the tension and the melodrama of her situation. She brings you along as she hides behind the bushes and climbs through windows just to meet with her lover out of the oppressive gaze of, I don't know, TMZ, I guess? Can't blame her. And despite the short amount of time to build up to it, she manages to pay off all that tension into a soaring chorus. Taylor completely sells how exciting it is to be with this guy, and how much it throws her anxieties into sharp relief whenever she's around him. Something that gets fleshed out even more in the wonderfully thrilling bridge. Taylor starts spilling her guts as she spirals in her declining emotional state, admitting how much she's spiraling and confessing to her lover how much she wants him. And when he responds, everything clicks into place. It's a glorious moment of relief, finding out that he's absolutely into it. When the bridge repeats in the outro, it reads more like unfiltered excitement rather than sheer desperation. Finding love in the face of adversity is the central theme of Lover, and I never realized until writing this paragraph just how well Cruel Summer exemplifies that theme right from the start of the album. In all honesty, I'm being really facetious about the production issues. I don't actually mind them that much in practice, but they do make Cruel Summer hit quite a bit less hard than it really should. It's almost worse that the composition is too good for the production, because I can see the potential that just isn't being met. Even still, I feel like Cruel Summer deserved more than just an honorable mention. It's still one of Taylor's best pop songs to date, and it being the one Swifties chose to turn into the unofficial lead single for the gargantuan Eras Tour is proof that this is truly something special, even with its pretty bad case of congestion.
Cruel Summer by Taylor Swift. Finally a number one hit and finally on my best list. 19-year-old Loika would have been so happy. Okay, let's do that intro again. I am not changing this video's title.
These are my top 10 best hit songs of 2023. Number 10. Time does weird things to us all. We remember, we forget, we remember again, but never in exactly the same way. Memories distort with time, and as we progress further and further into human history, the past only becomes more and more nebulous.
In other words, even though the sound of pop music in the early 2020s was people trying and failing to recreate future nostalgia, teenagers who are too young to remember living in the era will believe that the early 2020s sounded like this. Take a look inside your heart, is there any room for me?
I won't have to hold my breath till you get down on one knee because I didn't even listen to her music that much until this year, but I'm glad that we're finally starting to give Pink Panthers her flowers for basically redefining music for a new age. Apart from her being one of the biggest trailblazers for the TikTok age of music, her unique sound, founded in the combination of her soothing and wispy yet haunting and precise vocal style, and her taste in gentle, delicate melodies combined with frenetic, hard-hitting sounds like two-step and UK garage, has made her one of the most recognizable artists of our time. She's created such a unique yet compelling lane for herself that we're already starting to see the ripple effects of her influence. You'll see more of it on this very list. Given the impact that she's had over the past few years, it's astounding that she's only now getting her big breakthrough in the mainstream. Luckily, she is not sacrificing any of her charm. Every time I pull my head. The vibes are absolutely immaculate. Sean Fay Wolf described it as the sound of a PS1 Barbie dress-up game, and I can't do much better than that because that's exactly what it sounds like. Pink Pantheress and Muramasa's production creates such a dreamy soundscape, with blooping chiptune synths and gentle piano hits that would sound exactly the same coming out of a Game Boy Advance, backed by a subtle yet propulsive Jersey Club beat that gives the song that signature, gently frenetic energy that many of Pink Pantheress's songs have. Her sweet and cold performance delivers palpable melancholy as she laments on a boy who only loved her superficially.
You only want to hold me when I'm looking good enough. Did you ever fool me? Would you ever picture us? Every time I pull my hair out, was any outfit that you'll find me ugly and one day you'll disappear.
Her burned feelings are palpable as she expresses her frustration over having to work so hard to do herself up just for the chance of him expressing any love back, as she realizes how much time and energy she wasted trying to please a guy that she will never truly be enough for, who would lose interest the moment she deviated from his ideal image of her. Her burned feelings are elevated by her performance. Her voice is so cold and borderline robotic that any slight hint of emotion that shows through holds so much power. When she sings that line, I can feel her anger bubble over ever so slightly, yet it hits me like a truck. She may as well be screaming like Billie Eilish. Her anger becomes contemptuous amusement as she proclaims what the boy is in one of the stickiest hooks of the year. She gets to affirm her frustration and transform it into detachment as she burns her bridge from the boy, maintaining her Mona Lisa coolness while still getting to call him out on his shit. Her performance casts dark and stormy clouds over the song's thoroughly pink soundscape. She creates a delightful contrast between the two, painting a thoroughly unique picture that evokes a sort of coolly detached sadness, pale blues and pinks splashing against each other like a Barbie doll left in a light drizzle. These vibes are so immaculate that it's hard to conceive of any way to add on to them.
In that regard, it's really impressive how well Ice Spice steps up to the plate.
He said I'm good enough, got him out there, think about shit that I shouldn't have.
For the absolutely insane year that she's had, this is where Ice Spice shines the brightest. For one, Pink Pantheress actually trusts her to rap over the original beat. Ahem. But also, she's insanely efficient with the 30 seconds she gets.
Like that boy is a cap. Saying he home, but I know where he at. Like,
in comparison to the first character dealing with feelings of inadequacy, Ice Spice's character is actively getting cheated on. He mocks her for worrying, but between his avoidance and him hanging around with another girl, she can't tell if he even wants her anymore. It's a simple premise, but while it might seem like Ice Spice isn't the right person for the job given her past work, her verse is really powerful for a lot of the same reasons that the original works. Whereas Pink Pantheress's brand of detachment is smooth and gentle, Ice Spice's detachment is lighthearted and chill. Ice Spice as a persona seems to be so chill about pretty much everything, so when she gets mad about her boy cheating on her, any sign of emotion hits like a brick wall. Whereas Pink Pantheress's character is frustrated and done with this shit, Ice Spice's character is riddled with anxiety. You can hear it get to her head and just barely come through in her voice as she keeps getting blown off by him.
So I tell him it's one of me, he making fun of me, his girl is a bum to me.
You can feel her seething as she wonders if he's sleeping with the other girl. Fear and anger mixing together while she can do nothing but look out of her bedroom window.
Like that boy is a cap, saying he home but I know where he at. Like, but he blowing her back, think about me cause he know that it's fat.
And that anxiety culminates at the end of her verse.
But I don't sleep enough without you, and I can't eat enough without you. If you don't speak, does that mean we're through? Don't like sneaky shit that you do.
Somehow Ice Spice performed one of the most heartbreaking lines of the year. It takes a special kind of monster to make Ice Spice of all people feel like she's not enough. That's literally Ice Spice. How dare you? Boys a Liar is a perfect pop song for the modern time. Dig deep enough and there's so many layers to its emotional resonance, but even if you're not listening that deeply, it's just a fantastic jam. Pink Pantheress is perfecting her craft in the lane that she's made for herself, and Ice Spice is arguably the perfect complement to her energy, at least for this one wonderful moment.
All it needs now are goofy ass sound effects. There, now it's a pop song for the modern time.
Number 9.
There. Now it's art.
One of the most wonderful things art can do is inspire others to create art of their own. It's especially magical when that other person is a fellow artist stuck in a creative rut. There's something miraculous and profoundly human about being on either end of that exchange, to find that motivation locked away inside of you and to be the one that unlocks it. I've been on the receiving end of that exchange a couple times. It's what inspired my beautiful boys, Kandar and Nufur.
It turns out that this next song is a result of this phenomenon. It's actually kind of reassuring to know that this can happen to anybody.
I didn't really get this for a while. My first impression on release was that it was a perfectly good Billie Eilish ballad about a Barbie doll confronting the nature of her existence. But apart from not breaking new ground for Billie herself, the premise itself also felt really predictable.
Turns out I'm not real, just something you paid for.
If you told anyone to come up with a sad story about a Barbie doll, the first idea anybody would come up with is, what if Barbie realized she was nothing but a plastic doll? Melanie Martinez has probably written a song about that before. Nothing wrong with being predictable, I just felt like it was a bit cliche and forgettable. In fact, I indeed completely forgot about the song until the night of July 6th when I saw Barbie in the theater. My second impression afterwards was that it fit really well in the movie, almost too well. It's really on the nose for the plight of Margot Robbie's Barbie, which is all fine and good for a movie song, but as I've explained before, I generally don't get a lot out of musical numbers that can't be separated from their source material unless I can get something out of it. As time went on though, especially as more and more people caught the movie and found this song to be one of its biggest takeaways, I found myself more and more entranced by the song. Sure, it's not pushing the envelope for Billie and Phineas, but damn if they aren't good at what they do. It's quite telling that the movie's most pervasive leitmotif is that one four-note piano line, because as it turns out, that is one hell of a hook. It's full of melancholy, conveying the mourning of a human need that feels impossible to obtain. Phineas's production is subtle but powerful, conveying vast but cavernous space in its smallest moments, filled with nothing but Billie's cloud of sadness, and perfectly amplified by beautiful strings and the most subtle yet thunderous percussion hits possible as the song builds. As much as Billie has a reputation for sad songs, she doesn't really have a lot of straight-up piano ballads like this. While I love all the cool production tricks the siblings do on their other tracks, it's wonderful to see them show every now and then just how rock-solid their foundation is without all the other tricks up their sleeve. Even then, I still didn't fully get it until I saw Billie talk about how she came up with the song.
Like, we were really in a zone of feeling like we lost it, and feeling like, man, I don't know if we can do this anymore.
Billie has explained how she originally wrote the song purely from the character's perspective, literally writing as Margot Robbie's Barbie from the movie, but as she sat with the song for a while, she realized that pretty much everything she wrote about Barbie applies to her life as well.
The next week, I was playing it in the car all day and playing it for everybody, and I was like, this is exactly how I feel, and I didn't even mean to be saying it.
Suddenly, everything clicked for me.
To float, now I just fall down.
That could be about Barbie literally not being able to float anymore, but it can also apply to Billie herself, no longer finding joy in her craft, in what she used to enjoy so easily.
I was an ideal, not so alive. Turns out I'm not real, just something you paid for.
That can be about the nature of buying a Barbie doll, but it can also be about the transactional love between her as a performer and the people who consume her art. I've paid for her too, after all.
I can lie, say I like it like that, like it like that.
I'm sad again, don't tell my boyfriend, it's not what he's made for.
Every single lyric is exactly how I feel. Exactly how I feel. Every lyric, exactly how I feel. You hear me? Or you look at my mouth. It's exactly how I feel. It's about my life.
Her words, not mine. Anyway, I completely believe her, both her lyrics and her claim that she didn't intend to write this about herself. Like I said, I also thought it was just about Barbie at first, but once I started to realize how the words could apply to a real person, it started to hit a lot harder.
When did it end? All the enjoy.
suddenly, it wasn't just a song about a Barbie doll realizing she's a manufactured product. It was a song about falling into a rut. It was a song about flying high and loving life, only to fall into depression, wondering what changed. Why was it so easy before, and why does it feel so impossible now?
I used to know, but I'm not sure now what I was made for.
She approaches it so methodically, trying to contextualize her sadness and trying to find meaning when there isn't really any.
I don't know how to feel, but someday I might.
She even tries to reassure herself that she will eventually bring herself to a better place, even if that might be far away right now. What really gets me the most though, more than anything, is how lost she sounds. As much as she rationalizes her feelings and understands that better days will come, there's no getting around just how deep in the doldrums she is in the moment. She was able to do anything she wanted before. What happened? What changed? Why does she feel so burdened? How does she get out of this? What can she do? How long will this last? When did it end? What do I tell my boyfriend? How do I become happy again? What was I made for? It's not hopelessness. Billie knows very well that she will find her way out someday. But it's that worry over how to cope with what feels like insurmountable waves when you feel so powerless that really gets to me. It conjures the image of someone stuck at the bottom of a well, unable to climb up because they broke their leg. They know they'll get out eventually. Either someone will find them and help them out, or they'll build up the strength to climb out themselves. But who knows how long that'll take? What will they miss up above while they're stuck? What will become of them in that time? It's a light at the end of the tunnel that feels so far away. Logically, they know they'll get there eventually, but right now it feels so dark and lonely. And apart from tiny, incremental steps, there's not much they can do but wait. That's what Billie makes me feel.
Think I forgot how to be.
The more time passes, the more Billie truly feels like a generational talent, someone who will go down in history as one of the greats. Every time I hear someone talk about this song, they always seem to have a different reason why they love it. Yet every single time, I'm like, yeah, that's totally what this song is about. Very few songs are able to toe that line between emotional universality and thematic specificity, and yet Billie does it so well that she excels in both at the same time. That's a songwriter who knows her shit, and I genuinely believe that as long as they keep doing what they do, she and Phineas will go down in history as generational talents.
I'd like to believe that's what she's made for.
Something I'm made for.
I wasn't ready last year. I'm ready now.
All right, but aim upwind a little bit, huh? Yeah, and, yeah.
3, 2, 1.
SZA had a monster of a year. After years of straddling the line between cult following famous and actually famous, her long-awaited second album, SOS, finally made her the star that she always deserved to be and probably secretly was this entire time. People never stopped listening to Control for the record. Clearly, she was already a superstar. Even still, SOS's well-deserved success led to a healthy number of hits, and I'm faced with the impossible choice of which SZA song goes on the list. Kill Bill, Nobody Gets Me, Snooze, Low, I'd be happy with any of them here.
In the end, though, I'm surprised by what I picked.
I'm still a fan, even though it's salty. Hate to see you with some other, but know you happy. Hate to see you happy if I'm not the one driving.
Last year, I sort of wrote this off as not much more than a fun little novelty. I certainly liked it a fair bit, but it being the big hit and the second song off the album, it was clearly setting up for bigger and better songs down the tracklist. It's hard to compete with the likes of F2F and Gone Girl, and even amongst the singles, there was some stiff competition. I sort of put Kill Bill to the side all year, letting it do its thing, competing for the year-end number one spot it deserved while I enjoyed the rest of the album. As the year went on though, and I saw more and more love being thrown its way, Kill Bill really started to grow on me, and it started with that beat.
I'm still a fan, even though it's salty.
Something about the way the beat comes in positively tickles my brain. That cold, eerie, slightly playful synth giving way to the gust of hot wind from the bass and the drums, with SZA waiting until nearly the end of the first measure to come in and speak her piece, is one of the best 5 seconds of the year. You walk into a room with that intro playing and you feel so fucking cool. The entire production has a really cool air to it. There's a really interesting blend of modern production with classic textures and sensibilities going on here. There's something almost 60s about it. Between the old-timey chords sprinkled throughout the progression, the lo-fi textures of the drums and a lot of the production, the charmingly imperfect reverb and delay on SZA's vocals, and especially that warbling guitar. There's no mistaking the modern production, but it still manages to evoke the era and weave it into a tight package connecting now and then. I get the sense that this was a very deliberate choice too, because in true 60s fashion, Kill Bill is a story song and a murder ballad. You was out of reach, you was at the farmer's market with your perfect peach. Now I'm in the basement, planning on my patient. It's a simple setup. SZA's character is very much not over her ex who's seeing a new girl, and she's having very normal thoughts about it. You know, stalking, home invasion, premeditated murder, completely normal things to do after a breakup. It's nothing new for a murder ballad, but Kill Bill sets itself apart by just being really fun and uniquely really funny. I love the way SZA sets up her character, how she makes her very starkly deranged and blissfully unaware of her derangement, yet always putting her in situations where she feels the need to justify her actions at every turn. She sees a therapist because she knows it's the mature thing to do, only to completely blow off their advice and fixate on her ex anyway. I'm so mature, I'm so mature, I'm so mature, got me a therapist to tell me there's other men, I ain't doing one night. She starts to consider that maybe her ex really has moved on, only to be like, eh, fuck that, I still want you. I get the sense that it's a lost cause. I get the sense that you might really love her. The sex gon' be evidence, the sex is evidence. I try to ration with you, no murder's a crime of passion, but damn. She completely rationalizes why it's not a good idea to murder her ex before doing it anyway. I might kill my ex, not the best idea. And when she finally does it, her first reaction is to get defensive about her sobriety, as if that makes her actions any more normal. I feel really out of my depth talking about why the humor works, but there's something really amusing about how her character is constantly faced with the reality that her actions are awful and irrational, yet she seems to have some cognitive shield blocking her from actually realizing she's in the wrong. It's someone constantly making the wrong decision for herself, wondering why things never go right for her, and making it everybody else's problem. This person will crash her car into your store and ask you why her order is taking so long. This person is Goop from Meet the Robinsons in that one scene.
Hey Goop, what's up? Cool binder.
Hey Goop, wanna come over to my house today?
They all hated me.
What makes everything click is how SZA frames her character's worldview, focusing on the absurdity of the whole situation. There's no girlfriend's next out. It's really easy to make a character like this insufferable, but SZA, being an expert in writing about complex and messy feelings, encourages you to empathize with her character's feelings of hurt and betrayal while helping you see the bigger picture of how much she's overreacting. The absurdity alleviates the situation, preventing you from taking the character so seriously that you either start agreeing with her or finding her insufferable, and puts the focus on how ridiculous it is that she doesn't see the situation in the same way that you do. It's such a tight balancing act, but SZA pulls it off flawlessly, pairing it with a beat that perfects an equally tough balancing act between smooth, menacing, and just cheesy enough to be endearing, and you got a recipe for a perfect murder ballad. I just killed my ex, not the best idea. Honestly, I could have put anything from SOS in this spot. I've gone back and forth between this and Nobody Gets Me, and there's even days where Snooze feels like the right pick. In the end though, I think Kill Bill's the most unique and interesting of the three, and even after over a year, it only gets better.
May SZA continue to prosper, and may nobody look under the wrong floorboard. Rather be in hell than alone.
Number 7. Remember the Pink Panther segment where I said we're already starting to see the ripple effects of her influence? I forgot to cite a source earlier, let me fix that. Ooh. I mean, that's basically what this is, right? It's a Pink Panther's track reverse engineered for K-pop. Smooth and gentle, yet frenetic and high tempo, thanks to UK Garage, Two-Step and Baltimore / Jersey Club influences, complemented by wispy and soothing vocals. That describes basically everything either of them make. Once I figured that out, everything about NewJeans' exceptional rise to stardom clicked. Of course they'd be huge. They're a K-pop group with a solid backing that have figured out how to recreate the already lucrative Pink Panther's formula in an even more marketable and universally appealing context. All that, on top of this being a pretty fresh concept as far as K-pop goes, and it's no wonder they've become the biggest act to cross over since Blackpink. By the way, I mean all this with as much respect and affection as I can muster. Sure, they're not the first to try a more low-key approach to K-pop, but aside from them tapping into another internationally popular niche, they are goddamn good at this whole low-key K-pop thing. One thing that makes their approach a little more unique is that whereas Pink Panther's soft vocals have a more Mona Lisa brand of detachment to them, the girls of NewJeans bring a little more warmth. They're not quite as cold and robotic as Pink Panther's, but they're still a lot more restrained and relaxed compared to a lot of their more bombastic and expressive contemporaries. NewJeans' whole vibe is that they're just a group of high school girls. Not necessarily girl next door kind of normal, but still very approachable. I feel like I knew girls like them when I was in school. A lot of their songs are about the joys of sweet, innocent young love and their ups and downs. And I think the idea is that you're supposed to feel like you can just hang out with them.
I wouldn't know, I'm 23. I'm not gonna be hanging out with these whippersnappers. What would you even talk about? Roblox? Skibbity toilet? Having iPhones shoved in your face at age 4?
Fundamentally, it's a simple song about a teenage crush, where the narrator admits their feelings for someone they've been pining for a long time, which is apparently about 3 months, but its sound seems strangely out of step with the theme. I got no time to lose. Some parts of the production do complement the rush and the anxiety of confessing to your crush. The high tempo and the breakbeat feel like your friends egging you on to say that you love them already, while the Baltimore / Jersey Club beat we all know and love by now feels like your heart erratically beating in your chest as you walk up to them and start talking. These foundational parts of the production make sense, but what feels strange is what's in the air. The synth pads that pervade the song, the heavenly vocals, and the lo-fi textures that add a beautifully imperfect human touch not only provide an immensely comforting complement to the frenetic beat, they also add a lot more dimension to this teenage love story. Do you want somebody like I want somebody? Perhaps all they do is signify the narrator's passion for their crush behind all the anxiety, but with how gentle and minor key the chords are, plus how calm and collected all the girls are on the track, it feels like the song is building distance between you and the situation, as if you're not living in the moment, you're remembering it. The scenario is playing out through rose-colored lenses. The pure anxiety is smothered by the rush of passion and a knowing happiness that comes from knowing what they said in response, and perhaps future memories of how the relationship would play out. It might not necessarily have worked out for the two of them, but it was the experience of teenage love that touched them the most. I got nothing to lose. That's how the girls are able to utilize the sound so effectively. Their performances feel detached, but not in a way that suggests apathy. Instead, it's a detachment that makes these lived experiences more romantic and beautiful, putting yourself in a third-person perspective to appreciate the beauty of how you feel. Stay in the middle, like you were little. Don't want no riddle. Might it just say it, but go say it. Perhaps these girls are still too young to see their own teenage experiences with such detached lenses, but I'd argue that's what being a teenager is about these days. It's about the nostalgia for times that haven't passed yet, where you realize in the moment that these are precious moments of your life that you'll one day look back on fondly, even if it might feel scary and messy right now. One day you'll be left with the romance, not necessarily of the crush, but of your own experiences, and that's what Ditto is to me. I feel a bit silly writing about the teenage experience considering that I'm going on 24, but I think yearning for the romance of the teenage experience is a universal trait that transcends generations. It's something that Lord's Pure Heroine embodied really well. How special it is to be able to appreciate your current state of being, even when you're a teenager. On a personal note, I believe that this is something you can do at any age. For as long as you're alive, there's always time to find love in what's around you and remember them fondly once they're behind you. Your teenage years are merely the first part of your life where you're able to do that. Even still, it's natural to have a special reverence for the innocence of your teenage years, and I think that's something Ditto embodies especially well. The girls of NewJeans are terrifyingly young, so I genuinely wish them all the best in this cutthroat industry. They're teenagers after all. Number 6. I think about us now and then. In 2020, a little song called Un Día came out. Four artists are billed in its title, and this song is the best thing any of these four artists have made to the best of my knowledge. It's the best song I've heard from Tiny, who creates a beautiful sonic landscape tinged with such powerful tragedy that its tears shower the landscape like rain, as the multiple narrators play different sides of a relationship gone wrong. One day you'll love me again. It's the best song I've heard from Dua Lipa, who plays the lover whose trust has been broken by the other side's mistakes, who wishes they could one day be the partner they should have been this entire time, but knows how futile it is to wish for it. One day you'll realize I'm more than your lover, I'm more than your love, I'm your friend. It's probably the best song I've heard from J Balvin, though I don't know a lot of his own music, who plays the other side, who tries to buy her love back with extravagant gifts and good sex, but still holds resentment for her and is blissfully unaware that he was the one that messed up. It's also the best song I've heard from Bad Bunny, who also plays the other side but understands the situation better. He realizes that the rift between them is bigger than he thought before, but tragically, he still doesn't understand why it happened or how to fix it, so he falls into a spiral, longing for a touch they can't get again. Un Día reaches its climax in Bad Bunny's verse, the best thing I've ever heard him do. The pain and desperation in his voice is palpable, and he meets Dua and Tiny where they're all at to create a beautiful moment of yearning tragedy, making you believe that there is hope in something so hopeless. Bad Bunny has not topped this yet, but this year he did something that kinda reminded me of it. That's enough for me. Me queda un por ciento, y lo usaré solo para decirte lo mucho que lo siento. Of all the regional Mexican acts that blew up this past year, Grupo Frontera has caught my attention the most. Maybe I'm more of a cumbia person than a corridos tumbados person. It turns out a lot of the traditional Malay music I've grown up around kinda sounds like it. From the small sampling I've had, Grupo Frontera seems to have a really good grasp on traditional yet beautiful melodies that they put a lot of heart into. And I think Un Por Ciento is their best showcase so far. Ya nada me hace reír, solo cuando veo las fotos y los videos que tengo de ti. This song sees the narrator wallowing in sorrow long after the end of a relationship. The light in his heart has been snuffed out now that they're gone. He's sad that they're no longer around, but it breaks his heart even more that they're doing so much better these days because he realizes that he was the one holding them back. Quizás te hice un favor cuando me fui de tu lado. Borracho viendo tus fotos, me duele ver que tú seas mejorado. They made him feel whole, but he couldn't make it up to them. All I have is 1% on my phone, and I'm gonna use it to say how sorry I am. Shit. Shit, my phone died. Shit.
supieras que te escribí. Te he mandado los mensajes, siguen todos ahí. Wow.
It's pathetic, but the song finds pathos in the narrator's guilt and regret, channeling his heartbreak into catharsis. From the opening notes, the acoustic guitar and the accordion followed by the bass flood the atmosphere with a mournful sadness as frontman Payo Solis channels the narrator's regrets with his soulful, impassioned performance. Once the atmosphere is established,
ya nada me hace reír. Solo cuando veo las fotos.
Coming from a pop music perspective, it's kinda hard to explain how Un Por Ciento manages to convey sadness. This cumbia sound is inherently very organic, communal, and bouncy, with hand drums and accordions and classic guitars all jovially jamming out. It's a very fun sound, and it's hard not to have fun with it. Grupo Frontera sound like they're having an absolute blast performing the song, but the key is that they know how to perform both the sadness of the text and the joy of the genre. More than anything, they make it sound like they love performing more than anything in the world. Every word they sing, every note they play, every beat they hit sounds like it fills their soul to the brim. If they play a happy song, that's energy they're sharing to the whole world. But if it's a sad song like Un Por Ciento, that's a strong, complex, yet universal emotion that they get to relate with to the entire world. They make it sound like they feel every word they sing. And even if they don't sound sad, they sound empathetic. They make it sound like there's no greater joy in the entire world than getting to go up on stage, play their hearts out, and watch the people in their audience cry their lungs out as they feel every word in their soul. That is the joy of performance in its purest form, and they seem to understand that better than anyone else, including Bad Bunny apparently. That's my one gripe. I'm not quite as fond of Bad Bunny's part. I still like his part. I really enjoy how the song hard cuts to these beautiful synth pads to welcome him, and his melodies are equally beautiful. I also enjoy the transition back into the cumbia production. Bad Bunny's a surprisingly good fit on this production, but for whatever reason, he just isn't able to fully maximize the song's emotional pathos. His chorus falls especially flat. Benito is not quite as soulful a singer as Payo Solis, but I've heard him being soulful before, so it's not like he's unable to reach that height. It also doesn't help that he's not really backed up very well at the end. When Payo sings his choruses, the band works with him and his voice is backed up by layering and harmonies. When Benito comes in, not much really changes and it sounds like he's just singing karaoke. Apparently, the band members were not aware that Bad Bunny was going to be on the song until literally the middle of filming the music video.
Hicimos una vuelta del video con la versión que grabamos nosotros. Y luego llega Edgar y dice, la vamos a cambiar un poquito. Y ya llegó enfrente de nosotros y nomás escuchas que dice, muchachos, ¿cómo andamos? Y
todos
como que...
As fun as that must have been for the band, it probably would have been more helpful if they knew beforehand. They probably could have fine-tuned this collab better or something, you know? Even still, that's a relatively minor nitpick. Benito still sounds great, he mostly got the assignment, and The Foundation is still a gorgeously heartbreaking song. It kind of reminds me of stuff like Dancing on My Own by Robin, how it manages to utilize the conventions of a genre to tell a truly tragic tale in a way that can only be conveyed in that genre. I don't know how much more regional Mexican music we'll see in the mainstream, and for that matter, how much of it won't be watered down corporate schlock, but at the very least, Un Por Ciento will be a shining example of the genre's power. Now, in the wise words of the average commenter, charge your damn phone. So far in the 2020s, we've seen our fair share of musical trends pop up. Disco, bedroom pop, drill, hyperpop, Jersey Club, regional Mexican, all that good stuff. However, there's a smaller yet very present trend I've noticed that I haven't seen people talk about as much. Forget the 80s or the 70s, we're going mid-century, baby! I I guess mid-century pop is probably the best term for it. It's not quite as ubiquitous or huge as the other trends, but I've seen enough songs get big with the kids that would fit right into my grandma's karaoke nights. Sometimes it comes up in small ways, like the subtle influences in Billie Eilish's work. Sometimes it's full-on tributes, like Steven Sanchez's big hit. Leve got big in the first place by combining mid-century pop styles with modern songwriting sensibilities. And now, another artist is getting her big break thanks to it. I'm honestly kind of surprised it's taken this long for Mitski to get a hit. Not only has she been an indie darling for years, capturing the hearts of Pitchfork and lesbians alike, it feels like she's already had several hits, even if they didn't reflect in chart success. I mean, we've all heard Nobody and Washing Machine Heart, right? Either way, she's here now. It makes sense that of all the songs from her latest album, this would be the big hit from it. The album is more folk and country influenced than her usual output, but otherwise the album overall is about as dynamic, vulnerable, and oblique as you'd expect from Mitski. My Love, Mine All Mine is a lot more direct and simple compared to the rest of the album, but considering that it tends to take me ages to really get some of her more challenging songs, I'd say that's not a bad thing at all. No tricks, no experiments, just a simple, gorgeous song about… love? The song is punctuated by halftime drums and a sprawling pedal steel as the narrator sings to the moon with great reverence. Mitski captures the immense scale so gently. She makes herself look so small, a mere mortal creature communicating with a great celestial being, a being that feels nearly as old as time itself. Every living creature in history has looked up to that same moon, and every creature to ever live on Earth will look up to it too, provided Dr. Eggman doesn't pee on it.
How do you like that, Obama? I pissed on the moon, you idiot!
Even if it's not immune to his super laser piss, the narrator is still so much smaller, yet they still get to communicate. I just love the imagery. The thought of a person getting to face such an immense force in such a tender setting. There's a deep reverence, but there's no fear, only respect. And love. It's my love, it's mine, all mine. I love my. Mitski sings about love, but not about being in love or about losing love or anything like that. She sings about love, like the emotion and the act of love. She tells the moon that as a mortal, nothing is truly hers. Material possessions, people in her life, her own body, anything tangible can always disappear through forces out of her control, and eventually they all will. She realizes that the only thing that truly comes from her, the one thing that she can always choose to give, is her love. The feelings that develop inside her that she can always choose to do whatever she wants with. But that too is only as long as she's around. Once she's gone, that love dies with her, or at the very least she won't be able to share it. She's accepted the loss of everything else when she's gone, but her love is too precious, too important to waste. In her conversation with the moon, a little mortal bug getting the chance to talk to such an immense celestial body, all she asks for is if it can use its immortal power to carry on the one legacy a mortal could ever hope to share, the one thing that truly comes from her soul. Love.
Tell me if I could send up my heart to you. So when I die, which I must do, could it shine down here with you?
And it's not necessarily a specific kind of love either. She does specifically ask if her love can be shared with a particular loved one, the one who taught her the value of love in the first place.
My baby.
However, it's not just for her. It's a truly deep appreciation for the mere ability to love. A love for the world, for people, for life, for the experience of being human. She sounds so grateful to get to experience everything life has to offer, and her very soul yearns to let everyone and everything feel her love, even when she's gone, because this love truly feels all-encompassing and eternal. It conveys the truly infinite power that love has. How you can feel so much of it that you can express it forever and still have the same amount left over. It's so simple and natural that everybody experiences it, yet it's so immense that the only way to exhaust it is by seeking the help of a higher power. On a more concrete level, the mid-century ballad is such an inspired sonic backdrop to accompany this idea. It's the sound of a classic love song, slow and gentle yet melodramatic. If you made a song like this about a particular person, they better be the love of your life, otherwise it'll sound absolutely ridiculous. Mitski uses the power of this sound's melodrama to maximize the power of this idea. You hear her love in every element of the song. In the lyrics, in the pedal steel, in the gentle piano, in the soft-spoken drums, in every little inflection in her voice, her gratitude and appreciation for the world and all who inhabit it is impossible to miss. Mitski took this sound, flipped it on its head a little, and gave it a level of pathos that truly realizes the full potential of the sound. Mitski's ode to love is powerful because it understands how big it can truly be. Mitski's brilliant songwriting makes love feel as infinite, timeless, and deserving of attention as it truly is. When I look up at the full moon as I write this, I wonder if it's the song or billions of years of life showering their love down on me that's making me feel everything. Either way, that's Mitski's power.
It better be love shining down on me. I am not ready for Dr. Eggman's super laser piss.
Halloween. What a fun, frightful, festive season. Depending on how you look at it, it's either far too late or far too early for me to bring it up, but I'm doing it anyway because I want to discuss an often overlooked concept: spooky pop songs. I love that shit. Whether you try to lean into the inherently goofy campiness of the festive season, or you're genuinely trying to unsettle or terrify, or anything in between, taking advantage of fear to create genuinely fun and exciting pop songs is a formula that I feel gets somewhat underutilized. I love when musicians try to intentionally lean into these aspects and land themselves their rightful spots on Halloween playlists, but I especially love when an artist does this unintentionally. NDA by Billie Eilish is my favorite recent example. Did you think I'd show up in the limousine? Had to save my money for security. It's clearly meant to be about her real paranoia over stalkers and fame, but it turns out making a song about the fear and dread of being stalked translates really well into the spooky vibes of a good Halloween playlist.
I wholeheartedly believe this next song should be on that good Halloween playlist. Hear me out. Are you serious? I try, but I can't figure out. I've been next to you all night, I still don't know what you're about.
I'm not terribly surprised that this has been so polarizing. Tate McRae suddenly becoming a big pop star probably wasn't on a lot of people's bingo cards this year, and I think a big reason why, apart from people not really knowing her very well in the first place, is because her shortcomings are really obvious. Her breakthrough as a singer made her look like a copycat, and her following attempts to shed that image only made her look even more like a chameleon without her own vision. It also doesn't help that her Welcome to My Kitchen style of vocals is a polarizing choice as is. For better or worse, these traits are still very much present and greedy. Tate has traded in the Billy and Olivia costumes for a Britney Spears costume, which to her credit, definitely fits her better. Her scratchy vocals combined with her genuinely incredible dancing chops, thanks to her time as a famous child dancer, makes her a pretty good fit for a modern Britney. However, Tate's odd vocals and subpar enunciation make the image a bit of a hard sell. He said, I'm just curious, is this for real? More importantly for the song itself, though, she isn't yet able to project the kind of self-assured confidence that she's clearly gunning for in the lyrics. Tate plays the role of a cool, enigmatic woman getting hit on at the club by a pushy guy who is way below her league, but the double whammy of her shaky lyrics and her inability to convey that confidence through her vocals causes the whole conceit to fall apart. So sure of yourself. She sounds almost scared when she sings. In fact, a lot of stuff in this song projects a sort of fear rather than confidence. Don't her words seem a little strange? Baby, please believe me. I'll put you through hell. That shit won't end well. She doesn't sound annoyed or unbothered or too cool for him. She sounds terrified. It sounds like she's giving the guy an honest warning that she'll tear him apart if he gets too close. Not because she wants to, but because she can't control her power. She talks about herself like she's a werewolf or something. Like she's begging him to stay away or else she'll rip him to shreds without even realizing it. It gets to the point where by the third verse, the guy's pretty much given up.
He said, I'm just kidding. Is this for real? Just and I can't tell if you love or hate me. Never met someone like that.
He isn't even trying to make a move anymore. He's just genuinely curious about why she's being so standoffish. It seems really strange for a guy like this to back off so easily. Like he's a jock in a horror movie, finally confronting the horror and completely dropping his tough guy act.
Are you starting to see what I mean with this whole Halloween comparison?
It's not just the lyrics either. From the start, that ringing hang drum hook is low-key menacing as all hell. I feel like you can hear it best by slowing them down to half speed. It sounds like the start of a horror movie. It pervades through the verses and into the chorus, which also adds these ghostly wails into the background, haunting the mix. Everything adds up to paint a truly spooky picture of this girl. She's not a confident girl boss who's too good for any man foolish enough to approach her. She's an unstoppable beast lurking in the shadows, cursed by her own power and unable to stop herself from destroying anything she touches. Tate isn't capable yet of conveying true menace intentionally, but the song plays to her strengths and weaknesses by turning this concept into a fun, campy romp.
It's the perfect setup for a great Halloween pop song, and it also helps that it's just a great fucking pop song.
As much as I've compared Tate McRae's current reinvention to Britney Spears, many people have correctly pointed out that Greedy is a lot more comparable to Timbaland's work in the 2000s, specifically the stuff he made with Nelly Furtado.
Roses are red, some diamonds are blue. Chivalry is dead, but you're still kinda cute.
Hey. I see you are hiding me down, but you'll never know much past my name.
I can't keep my mind off you. Who you at? Do you mind if I come through?
Boy, how I'm running this room around and I'm still half your age.
The production especially is a dead ringer, from the rhythm of the kick drums and the clappy snare hits to the really cool rattling cowbell thing. They all combine together in a way that creates that spacious yet groovy feel that Timbaland's beats are famous for. It makes sense that Greedy manages to capture his vibe so well, considering that it's produced in part by his protege Ryan Tedder of One Republic fame.
It's too late to apologize.
This man is so all over the place, having produced and wrote so many of the best and worst songs ever conceived. So I'm kinda surprised it's taken this long for him to try and rip Timbaland's style considering that he basically started his career. It turns out that not only is he really good at ripping him off, he manages to expand on his sound by incorporating his own knack for melodies. It's something I've always respected Ryan Tedder for, and he brought his A-game on Greedy. This first thing is more of a Timbaland thing, but while the ringing hang drum hook does sound spooky when it's slowed down, speeding it back up reveals it to be the insanely catchy hook that it is. Combined with the fantastic rhythm section, it only grows more infectious and groovy the longer it plays. The verses establish the fantastic rhythm, but from the chorus, Tedder's influence expands on it. The synth pads and the ghostly wails flood the track with a gorgeously spooky atmosphere, and Tate's squeaky, scratchy vocals are utilized so ingeniously to convey a looming sense of danger while also slotting in absolutely perfectly into the overall composition. I just adore this chord progression, and how all of the melodic elements progress and pay off. The way the chorus comes in kinda reminds me of Colors by Halsey, and that's low-key one of the best pop songs of the 2010s, so that's a shining achievement.
Everything is blue.
Greedy Reedy has a fantastic rhythmic foundation, it's got fantastic melodic composition, and they dance with each other so harmoniously to create something even better than the sum of its parts. As it turns out, that makes for a great song. The idea of main pop girl Tate McRae is still really bizarre to me, but I do kind of get why that's happening. Her relative lack of personality on record makes her pretty easy to mold into whatever image she wants, her dancing chops make her a perfect candidate to be a dance diva, and most crucially, after the music industry spent the entire TikTok age doing nothing to invest in their artists, leading to the power vacuum we see in the charts today, one of the big record labels decided to start actually doing their jobs by promoting a pop star, and Tate McRae just so happened to be in the right place and the right time to be the guinea pig. As it turns out, it worked. If Tate really aspires to become a great pop star in the long run, I think she has a lot of work to do to find her artistic voice. But in regards to Greedy, I think the stars really aligned with her on this one. It manages to work within the confines of her limitations, and whether or not it was intentional, managed to expand on them to create something truly special. Wherever Tate McRae goes next, this is a damn good notch to have under her belt. Her hockey glove, I guess. This aesthetic is really cool, I'm not even gonna lie. Number 3. Whenever an artist releases something that is at least speculated to be about some kind of real-life drama, said real-life drama always seems to overtake the conversation. Broadly speaking, I think it's kind of an unfortunate phenomenon since it often draws attention away from the music itself, and also because this usually only happens to women for some reason. Sometimes though, a song is so immediately obviously good that it stops people in their tracks and gets them jamming along without caring about who it's about. Sometimes it pays to be petty as fuck. That's not to say people don't care about Shakira and Gerard Piqué. They're obviously both massive celebrities in their own fields, and I've covered their story before, but I think it's a real testament to the track that it's crossed the language barrier to get people invested in Shakira's side of the story. I won't go into detail about their 12-year relationship or their breakup sparked by Gerard cheating on her with a girl half her age for the sake of time, but what makes Shakira's takedown of Gerard truly unique is how little she holds back and how much fun she's having while doing so.
Sorry, baby. Hace rato que yo te vi tocar ese gato.
She goes for the jugular as she calls out all the different ways he's been a piece of shit, but she also fully embraces the petty nature of making a diss track by airing her grievances in the most fun, ridiculous, and petty ways she can get away with. She discredits his decorated football career. She references her own career highlights a couple times. She name drops him and the girl he cheated on her with through puns. And she also says this, which I think is really funny. Combined with her having every right to be angry about how he treated her and tossed her to the side, Shakira makes you want to root for her, and every witty line about the guy turns you into Super Hot Fire's posse. Other breakup songs usually find their power in their righteous fury or their ability to call out their exes for the pieces of shit that they are, but Shakira's ability to channel her pettiness and wit into making the whole ordeal fun is truly admirable. She's basically tapping into the instinct that gives you pleasure seeing a shithead getting dunked on Twitter, except you don't have to worry about the cost of giving that shithead a bigger platform. What makes it even better is that Shakira happened to know the perfect guy to produce this diss track. Beat-a-rap's beats are often pretty simple EDM-adjacent affairs, and this is no different, but his biggest strength as a collaborator is his ability to stretch these beats any way he needs to. It gives him and his collaborators a rock-solid foundation to build off of, and Shakira takes full advantage of that. The The beat accompanies her without alterations at first to let her ease her presence in, albeit with a few stuttering vocals and cutouts for emphasis, seemingly a Beats It Up trademark. Once she's done warming up, however, the beat starts to transform around her. Namely with the clattering drum break in the second verse to represent the turmoil he put her through that she ultimately concludes triumphantly. Once the ice is broken, the beat is ready for her true power, or rather, the beat will fit her, whether it's ready or not. This bridge is fucking awesome. Shakira was coming for the jugular before, but by this point, she's tearing him to shreds like the she-wolf she is, forgoing any previous melodies to let her barrage of attacks nuke this guy's ego. The beat distorts into an unrecognizable beast, barely hanging on to that 4/4 time signature as she comes for this man's life. The beat is a bastardized monster of itself by this point, but the swing that Beats It Up gives it puts it right in step with Shakira's limber energy, like a drunken fighter finding their greatest power when they're at their most unhinged. This is a shining example of the power of collaboration. Shakira already had a seemingly infinite amount of ammo against this guy that she was absolutely not afraid to use, but she found even more power in a producer who stepped into the role of the ultimate wingman by turning every shot she could fire into an atomic bomb. I truly don't know what could compel someone to do something as stupid as cheating on Shakira, and Gerard Piqué doesn't need credit for being the guinea pig to that experiment, but I'm honored that Shakira deigned to show the world what would happen if someone did such a foolish thing. Maybe she can do a little tax evasion after all, as a treat. Number 2. NewJeans made it onto the list by building on a fresh sound in their own unique way. This next act makes it onto the list by simply perfecting the usual formula. On paper, there's not really much to write home about. It's a tried and true pop song about flying high and achieving your dreams in the Disney Channel original movie lane of believing in yourself. Lines about dreams coming true, being the writer of your own story, going your own way, performing on a big stage, even if darkness falls, just fly high and you'll find your way. The kinds of cliches that writers typically only write when they're either irrevocably detached from reality or have given up all will to live, no in between. However, the key difference that sets I Am apart is how everyone involved commits to the bit. Sure, in a real sense, this could have been made with just as much cynical intention as any other Believe in Yourself anthem, but at the very least, I wouldn't be able to tell because I've sure as hell sound like they believe in you. Those opening notes expose you to a world of decadence before the driving synths yank you fully into it. The girls act as your guides into the world, showing you every luxury it has to offer while always reassuring you that they know where you're coming from emotionally, making you feel like they know what it's like to be in your shoes. The bright melodies and uplifting chord progression emphasize the pathos of the journey that you're embarking on, but the insane 6/8 groove, or whatever time signature it is, and the sonic palette of buzzing synths and pounding drum machines show you the excitement and chaos this world is capable of. The girls give you plenty of time in the verses and pre-choruses to bask in the glory and contemplate your journey to the top, but when the chorus drops, the song cannot hold back. The girls in the groove level out entire cities as they let themselves get swept up by the thrill of this lifestyle. Their vocals soar through the sky as they bask in the world of possibilities open for them, as they show you what is truly possible in this world. At every moment, the girls in the song alike sound so excited to share this world with you. They've worked so hard to get to a point where they feel like they can do anything, and they want nothing more than for you to experience it too. They're so happy and proud to have reached this point, and they're using all the force in the world to carry you up with them. That's what it sounds like every time those synths rev up. It sounds like a rocket taking off to space. That's the real power of I Am. More than getting rich and famous or whatever, the girls in the song want you to aspire to something and feel that sense of accomplishment, of pride in yourself. The driving beat gives you the drive to climb whatever mountain you have before you, and the melodies remind you of what's waiting up there for you once you reach the summit. The girls want you to succeed. They want you to keep climbing no matter what you face, and they truly believe you can do it. They are lifting you up and pushing you all the way to the very top. And this final chorus feels like the view at the summit, when you jump for joy at the realization that you've truly made it. Revving guitars celebrate your arrival as you finally fulfill your destiny, as you take in the view and watch the sights of your dreams finally coming true. The excitement and the pride come together to create a truly glorious, emotional victory lap. This song is the very feeling of success put to audio. Most songs of this nature don't work because they know damn well that meritocracy is a myth, and they know they're speaking bullshit when they tell you to just work hard and believe in yourself, which results in cynical pep talks with absolutely no heart put into them. I Am works in spite of that, because they have put so much heart into it that you can't help but believe in yourself. I believe that they believe, and that's truly what's most important.
It's also just a damn fucking good pop song. That's who this song is. I tried my best to keep these honorable mentions brief, but there's just too many of them and they're all so good. Please pray for me.
So I remember when we were driving in your car, speed so fast I felt like I was drunk.
I am not immune to Luke Combs' cover of Fast Car Propaganda. This was a solid second runner-up for the SZA spot behind Kill Bill and Nobody Gets Me. Imagine being SZA. Imagine being so good that this isn't even second place. And this was the third runner-up. It took me a minute to get it, but I'm glad I did. Hooks for Days, full band backing from Eslabon Armado, Peso Pluma being a fantastic compliment to frontman Pedro Tovar, any of these could be the reason why this was the best Corridos Tumbados hit this year. Lots of painful cuts this year, and this was the very last one. What a perfect little love song that effortlessly puts so much passion in such a gentle little package. Also, Selena Gomez has always been this good, y'all just don't get it. These girls deserved so much better. Mr. 96 explained the situation way better and more succinctly than I ever could. I am so angry over what happened, but I can only hope for the best for all the girls moving forward.
I'm super shy, but wait a minute while I'm making my...
I hope these girls are getting treated at least a little better. Anyway, this song is so subtly and insidiously good that it needs to be studied academically. Not as wild or cutting as the Pizza Rap collab, but it absolutely fucks nonetheless. Okay, fine, I like this song. This and Midnight Rain were the only growers for the record. If I hear droning bass synths or repeated vocal samples on that new album, I'm gonna throw hands in Fortnite with Post Malone. Speaking of, this was another pretty close cut for the list. Sure, it's not the most unique or innovative sound, but goddamn, Post Malone sounds so alive over it. Someday I'll get sick of guys ripping off Tame Impala. One day.
I ain't proud of all the punches that I've thrown in the name of someone I no longer know.
Great riffs and insane momentum. I feel like I need to wrap my arms around a couple guys' shoulders and sing really loudly out of tune to it for some reason.
So sure, then you're driving me home, and I don't wanna leave, but I have to go.
For some reason, I forgot to listen to this until after I finished writing the list. It's basically Phoebe Bridgers at home, but turns out Phoebe Bridgers at home is pretty good.
Now and then,
The song itself is pretty good, but I'm mainly just really touched by the story of the song. I'm genuinely honored to have been alive at the same time as a new Beatles release. Also, I always love a good slide guitar moment. This was also in heavy consideration. I'm glad that TikTok had good taste in Born This Way deep cuts. Still waiting for that Mary Jane Holland revival. Anytime now. This probably would have made it on the list if I weren't still recovering from self-inflicted overplay. This is what 2017 sounded like for all the teenagers watching this who wished they were teens in 2017. For the record, 2017 also sounded like shitty guys in high school parodying Ugandan Knuckles memes, so count your blessings, kids. Kissing, I hope they cut us. What are they like or not? I wanna show you up. If it weren't for my visceral aversion to anything Doja Cat does at the moment, I'd be more willing to put Agora Hills on the list proper and call it her best single to date. Yes, that does include Streets. Like I said, the Pink Panthers effect is already spreading far and wide, and we're getting some damn good talent and music out of it. I haven't had much time to engage with Dua Lipa's official comeback, but Houdini growing from it's fine to okay, this is much catchier than I thought is a great sign. I still stand by all my criticisms of this. I had an epiphany the morning I wrote this segment that the song it reminds me of the most is Fingers Crossed by Lauren Spencer Smith. And I give you my hours and advice just trying to fix you. It's all you hurt me, you did me wrong, you were a bad person in some non-specific way, I was a fool to love you, without any tangible allusions to what even happened between them. And any details they provide don't help to clear it up, so they don't actually add anything. They're like bad emo songs almost. No matter how justified the situations are, without any actual ammo to fire against the guys that did them wrong, I can't empathize with their situations. That said, Vampire gets so catchy from the bridge onwards that all of that just melts away. I can't hate it too much when the rollicking indie rock groove is this good. Also, Olivia gave me by far my most successful video ever, so I'm basically obligated to put it here anyway. Thank you, Olivia. Adam Young from Owl City must be the most wonderful man to ever live if he inspired Taylor Swift to write this about him. This is her best song to date, and it would have been number one if she pushed it at all. Fuck up the world, excuse me, but is that your girl? If she tell, that's a good referral. This song is insane. I want more. This pussy depressed, I'm about to stress him. Yeah, pigtails round his neck, but this ain't domestic. I initially wrote a paragraph here where I was like, oh, I wish this was bigger, Megan deserves a hit, blah blah blah. I think we're good now. Keep the energy going. My favorite song to come out of the 90s techno revival this past year. Calvin and Sam, please keep working together for the rest of time. Apart from being a fantastic 2000s inspired acoustic jam, Troy Sivan also wins the Cupcake Plunger Award for the best ad lib of the year. You should ensure that we- Kylie Minogue's Tension was one of the best albums of the year. I'm very grateful that Kylie got an actual hit this year through Padam Padam, but the rest of the album deserves the treatment too. This is basically a Porter Robinson track in spirit. This shit gets me higher on life than a nihilist at Applebee's. I'm Same for Heaven Knows. The album pitch is basically just what if Pink Panther has had a budget and songs longer than 2 minutes. But it turns out, that leads to a damn good album with a damn good closer. What a beautiful composition, and what an incredible build. Please keep giving Pink Panther hits. I want to see where she goes.
I put that on my mama, on my hood. I look fly, I look good.
Literally adding this in the script right as I record this at the end of February. I am so sorry I slept on Jaguar 2. That was one of the best albums of last year as well. Just immaculate R&B.
Give it all some time. Paralyzed emotion.
Hot take, I thought The Loveliest Time was just alright. It is pretty good and it's got some jams, but it doesn't hold a candle to The Loneliest Time. This one is great though, especially that intro. Another great song for annoying gay people like me to show people who still call her the Call Me Maybe girl.
When I talk to you, oh Cupid walks right through.
Really, the entire Bewitched album should be in this spot, but From the Start is a great representation of how Levy expertly weaves modern lyrical styles and classic music sounds together. Shout out to Family Guy. Gag Order was the album of the year, easily. It's a genuinely harrowing listen where Kesha tells you exactly where years and years and years of trauma under Dr. Luke has led her. Thank God she's finally out of that legal battle and out of that contract. Where's my nickel? TK Maiza continues to be one of the coolest, grooviest musicians out there, and y'all continue to not listen to her. One of you needs to change your ways, and it's not TK. Stream Sweet Justice. Here's some background that I need to rush through for time. In 2020, a friend showed me a couple songs by a new Korean band called Dareharu that they were really into, and I thought their songs were really good too, even though they only had 2 songs at the time. Tragically, their writer and composer Ampstyle suddenly passed away later that year, merely 2 singles into their career. The band understandably goes inactive afterwards, until 2023 when they suddenly drop a 3rd single, written at least in part by Ampstyle and completed by the surviving band members, and it's so fucking good. It's got hooks, it's got drama, it's got dynamics. It's got Chohee's wonderful emotive vocals, it's got everything. As much as I wish Ampstyle were still around, I just feel honored that we got to enjoy this. That post-chorus is the coolest thing ever. If I had an Artist of the Year award to give out, I'd give it to Hemlock Springs. She seems to be incapable of not making cool ass music. Anyone actually took a minute to grow on me, but I grew to really love its gentle build. It's almost cinematic, how small it starts as she slowly explores her world of love and realizes how rough of a path it can be, especially for unfair reasons beyond her control. The chorus snippet I heard didn't really grab me at first, but within the full package, it has me screaming if there's anyone for me to love too. I've been trying to figure out what it is about Hemlock Springs that grabs me so specifically so much, but then I realized, Hemlock Springs makes the kind of music that I remember from my childhood that I absolutely adored, but that I can't verify actually existed. I remember as a kid being obsessed with this one CD that my older sister owned. It had artwork of spiders over a white background on it, and I'd play it all the time. I don't remember what was on that CD at all or what it really sounded like, I just remember it being vaguely 2000s in some capacity. It could have been anything from Hey Ya to some indie rock classic, but all I know is that my specific memory of whatever that song was is the best song ever made. That's the music that Hemlock Springs makes. She makes music that sounds like my memory of the songs I was obsessed with as a young child. She's so good at this whole pop music thing. Girlfriend made me think Hemlock Springs was a cool little oddity. Sever the Blight made me realize that she's a force to be reckoned with. Not that serious, artsy stuff is inherently better than bubblegum pop, but the fact that she can do all of these things so well is a testament to her immense potential. Her command on drama and bombast through her soaring vocals, powerful composition, and orchestral production makes her heart resonate even if I don't fully get the oblique lyrics. I don't know if the world is ready for Hemlock Springs, but if she keeps up her current momentum, the world will have to be ready one way or another. And now, the best hit song of 2023. It's not Escapism, that was last year. Number 1. There's a lot of reasons why a song can end up in this spot. Sometimes it's the song that meant the most to me, the one that touched my heart and spoke to the most vulnerable corners of my soul. Sometimes it's the song that blew me away the most, the one that rocked my world the hardest and changed how I perceived the artist who made it for the better. Sometimes it's the song that felt like the most creative artistic statement, the one that pushed the boundaries of the medium the hardest to tell a powerful story. Sometimes a song ends up on here simply because it's the best one. In hindsight, it's kinda wild how quickly the world embraced Olivia Rodrigo as the return of pop rock to the mainstream. Olivia is a ballad girl. Her big breakout single was a ballad, and Sour's tracklist was mostly made up of ballads. The only hint of her appreciation for 90s and 2000s pop rock were a couple novelty songs thrown into the tracklist, but she was already so good at it, and people loved them so much that she and Dan Nigro were like, okay, let's do more of them. And I think that's done a lot of good for Olivia so far. It's allowed her to grow a lot more rapidly as an artist than I think anyone would have expected. And I think if all goes well, instead of railroading her down a certain sound, this eagerness to try new things is gonna make her a much more prolific artist in the long run. That's what I mean when I say Guts delivered everything I could have hoped for. More than anything, despite its unassuming appearance, that album is a sign that she's growing in the right direction. Now, I can't talk about this without making the comparison between this and Brutal.
I'm so insecure, I think, that I'll die before I drink, and I'm so caught up in the news of who likes me and who hates you.
It's an obvious comparison because they're both grungy 90s alt-rock bangers, but as much as I love Brutal, its irresistible groove and Olivia's incoherently angsty ramblings and her slightly tongue-in-cheek humor, she's gotten a lot more tools since then, and those tools have gotten even sharper.
Haven't heard from you in a couple of months, but I'm out right now.
Whereas Brutal encapsulated her teenage angst in a small little ball of fury, Bad Idea Right makes a delightfully fun romp out of a predictably regrettable fling with a mediocre ex. In the transfer to the lighter subject matter, we lose absolutely none of the edge. Instead, we catch an insanely sticky guitar riff that captures the campy, rowdy night of debauchery that Olivia is about to embark on. This is a weird thing to say about a song, but this song is so well choreographed and animated. Like, this is one of the best songs ever to mime along to because Olivia delivers her lines so perfectly with this disaffected speak-sing affect that I can see exactly what she's doing in my head. I feel her rolling her eyes and sarcastically nodding her head as she senses his undertone. I feel her stretching her eyes to each top corner before scrunching her face and dropping her shoulders as she groans over the rose-tinted thoughts of him. I feel her mind getting fogged up by ill-advised urges, as the voices in her head dementedly bob side to side, completely blocking any rational thoughts that could stop them. I feel her anxiously furrow her brows as she debates whether she's actually gonna do it when she knows damn well that she shouldn't.
Seeing you tonight, it's a bad idea, right? Seeing you tonight, it's a bad idea, right?
I feel her eyes flash wide open in panic as she starts freaking out and frantically looking for someone to save her from her own bad judgment.
Seeing you tonight.
I feel her forcefully clamp down and collect herself before huffing an anxious breath to psych herself up. I feel her immediately get on the defensive against all her friends who are immediately going, "What the fuck? Why would you do that?"
Yes, I know that he's my ex, but can't you be worried? Can't I only see him as a friend?
I feel her looking into a secondary camera off to the side, like she's the animated version of Lizzie McGuire exposing her inner thoughts. I feel her miming the action and shrugging her shoulders as she playfully gives her excuse.
Balin, two is bad.
I could keep going. I feel the-
Stop.
Wait. Were we actually- okay. I guess we'll wait. Should I? It's a bad idea, right? It's like 2:30 in the morning. It's a bad idea, right? Ah, fuck it, it's fine. Come on. Why are these solids so hard to open? I don't get it. Come on. Come on. We're continuing? Okay, cool.
Anyway, I also feel the delightfully mischievous grin on her face as she holds back laughter over the foolproof plan that she concocted. My favorite bit, by the way. And I feel her squint up at the sky in wistful contemplation as she conveniently forgets about every other man on Earth. Olivia could probably keep going too, but by that point, the song itself decides that it has a few things to say as well. The second chorus comes to a pounding halt as Olivia makes her bed with this guy to welcome that absolutely bitching guitar. That's the most badass intro to a guitar solo I've heard since Rina Sawayama's Dynasty. And the ensuing solo goes absolutely bonkers as Olivia and her ex absolutely go for it. In the moment, it feels absolutely glorious, but that underlying groove and her more rational voices keep her subconsciously in check while they're doing it. Inevitably, the solo's over and the sparks are gone, and she's left with that guitar riff as she's left to steep in her regret. She'll probably laugh about this in the future, as long as it doesn't become a pattern at least.
Seeing you tonight, it's a bad idea, right? Seeing you tonight, it's a bad idea, right?
Every single aspect of the song is somehow both impossibly perfect and undeniably human. Olivia manages to convey the rush of the fling and the tension of the whole ordeal while keeping her perspective in check, like how SZA does in Kill Bill, creating a wild journey where you get to feel the exhilaration from her perspective and get a kick out of how foolish yet how relatable her actions are. Bad Idea Ride joins an exclusive club of songs that you are now legally obligated to mime along to, alongside classics such as 24 Karat Magic, We Are Never Ever Getting Back Together, and Trapped in the Drive-Thru.
I lean out the window and scream, hey, what you trying to do, blind me?
Olivia's starting to display an astounding ability to convey messy emotions through her performances as much as her writing, and this whole aesthetic puts her in a really unique position to expand on that ability exponentially and in ways you wouldn't expect. If this is what she's capable of at the age of 20 as I write this, and on her second album, I am truly excited for what she cooks up next. She might not ever top the comeback song, but a girl can try.
I'm sorry, I didn't order a glass of your opinion!
And now, for me to finish that bag of Han spicy chips with my name on it before I go to bed. It's fine, don't worry about it.